Hey guys, how's it going? Today I want to talk to you about spiritually transgender. But first, I want to take a drink. Oh yeah. Like my cup? Think it's too feminine for a guy? Do you think pink and flowers are exclusively feminine? What does it mean to be feminine? What does it mean to be masculine? Guys, I have my master's in humanities. I've studied culture. I can tell you guys, throughout history, different cultures, even contemporary cultures, their ideas and ideals of feminine and masculine are widely different. There's two arenas where we need to address the issue of gender and how to differentiate that, right? Physical and spiritual. Here's the reality. Gender and the spiritual and physical are opposite. In the physical, gender is binary. That's like no question, guys. There is male and female in the physical. Spiritual, opposite. In the spiritual, gender is non-binary. Okay. Wow, is that shocking? Well, let me read some scripture to you because, hey, Bible says it, I believe it, that settles it, right? So what does scripture say about being spiritually transgender? Because that's what scripture says, guys. You are spiritually transgender, physically gender binary, okay? Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God, he created them in his own image, male and female. What does that tell us, guys? God is male and female. God is also pure spirit. God is not spiritually male or spiritually female. He is spiritually male and female, non-binary. He did create a binary physiological paradigm, but that is only in the physical, okay? Well, let's flip to Jesus' own words in Matthew. Jesus is in a conversation with the Sadducees about the resurrection of the dead. And they tell the story of this woman that was married to seven different brothers because the law of Moses demanded it. And so they're like, ha ha ha, Jesus, who's she going to be married to in heaven? Ha ha, we got you. There is no resurrection of the dead. And Jesus, this is what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 22, verses 29 through 30. He says, you are in error because you do not know the scriptures or the power of God. At the resurrection, people will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They will be like angels in heaven. Angels are spiritual creatures, guys. They can't procreate. They aren't male or female. They are male and female because God is male and female because spiritually, we are non-binary. We are spiritually transgender. And Jesus, in this conversation with the Sadducees, says, you guys don't even understand God or the power of God or scripture. You don't even know, guys. You've got this paradigm and this understanding, and it's small-minded. And hey, guess what? Church is in the same place today. The church has this paradigm, and it's small-minded. They don't know the power of God or the scriptures. They're in error because they're only looking at the physical, right? Jesus, in the conversation about him being the bread of heaven and asking people to eat his flesh and blood, at the end of that, he says to the disciples, the words that I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. The flesh counts for nothing. Jesus, in that section of scripture, really says, hey guys, stop looking at the physical. The physical doesn't really matter. It's not the most important anyway. I mean, not that it doesn't matter what we do in the physical, of course. But he's saying the higher picture of reality comes from the spiritual. And spiritually, as Jesus points to in Matthew chapter 22, there's no gender. And when we die, guys, we're going to be like the angels, no gender. We're going to be, why? Because the truest essence of who you are is spiritual, and the truest essence of spiritual is transgender. It combines male and female. Okay? One more verse. Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 28. Paul writes, so in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free. There is neither male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. In Jesus, guys, there is neither male or female. What does that mean? It means that God does not care whether you're a girl or a guy. It's not important. So is the church putting too much emphasis on physical gender? And are you the right kind of guy? And are you the right kind of girl? And if you're a guy, you can't use a pink mug because that's a girl. Like, can't do that. Doesn't matter to God. Guys, it's not that defined. Like, we want to define it. And why do we define it so strictly? Because we're not looking at the spiritual. We can't see into the spiritual. We don't have a spiritual understanding. We have reduced everything, and we often do reduce everything to the physical. And we have this very reductionist mentality often as Christians. And if you don't look the right way and act the right way and talk the right way and show up at the right place and have the right truths, then you're not Christian. And it's like bullshit. Like, the church throughout its history, guys, has been so diverse in its thinking and its philosophy, its ideology, its expressions, and even the clothing styles. And like, today we've got Christians going, nope, can't do that, can't wear that, you can't be Christian. And it's like, well, then Jesus wouldn't be accepted in your church, guys, because he wore a dress. I guess Jesus was a cross dresser, wore a dress. Well, that was typical for his time, not for ours. So what does that tell you, guys? We're putting too much emphasis on the things that matter very little and no emphasis on the things that matter a lot. Here's the reality. The younger generations are more spiritually awake than the older generations. And so they are a lot more attuned to the reality that spiritually these things don't matter so much. The younger generations, guys, aren't as caught up in these gender specific categories. Why? God has so designed and desired the younger generations to be more spiritually awake for the new church he's bringing and for the new things he's wanting to do. And so you have the younger generations going, it doesn't matter. All these stupid stereotypes that you guys have clung to and made so dogmatic and made so essential, we don't care. So what? A guy can wear a dress. So what? A girl can wear slacks. So what? Here's the truth, guys. Concerning social issues, the church has always been behind and always been on the wrong side. In just the last 200 years, all the social issues, guys, the church has been on the wrong side. Slavery? The church affirmed slavery. Women's rights? The church affirmed a patriotic society where women couldn't vote, couldn't hold jobs, had to be married. So, interracial marriage. The church said, no, you cannot be married to people not of your own race. Divorce. The church said, nope, scripture says God hates divorce. If you're divorced, you can't divorce. That's a sin. That's wrong. Can't divorce. And if you divorce, well, you just sin and you can't remarry. And what is it today? Transgender LGBTQ. You're gay. Can't be a Christian. You're gay. Can't be a Christian. Nope. Can't be a guy and wear a dress and go to church. Nope. So have we learned from the history of the church, even in modern times? No. We have not learned. And of course, I know there's always that element of the church that's progressive and is like, hey guys, look, don't you see in the past how you've been wrong time after time after time after time? You've been on the wrong side of every social issue for the last 200 years, guys. How about now? Why don't we now just like say, okay, let's not do that again. There's always that progressive side of church, and they're always called heretics and they're hated until about 50 years later, it's like, oh, sorry, guys. I guess, I guess slavery was wrong. Oh, I guess interracial marriage was okay. Oh, I guess divorce isn't really like that big of a deal. Oh, I guess women should really vote and have their own say and be able to hold jobs and, But guys, here we are again. Transgender sexuality issues, and the church is going, basically, the church to the younger generations and to culture right now is doing this. F you. If you're this, if you're that, if you're LGBTQ, if you're blah, 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 F you. And you know what culture's doing to the church? Fine. Back at you. The culture right now, the younger generations especially, is doing one big F you to the church, because the church has been doing this to the younger generations. They're like, if you don't wear the right clothes, if you're not the right sex, if you're not conservative, if you're not blah, 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 if you're not theologically according to what we say. And the younger generations are like, fine, F you too, church. Why? Because the church is stuck once again in a social paradigm that's outdated. The church is not moving forward with the times, adapting with the times, adapting the ancient truths of God to the current situations. And so the mode of church is outdated, the expression of church is outdated, and the way that the church is approaching the younger generations isn't working, and the church is just doubling down. And the younger generations are like, fine. We don't have to go there. We don't need that. We'll find something else. We'll find our own way to Jesus, or we'll find our own spirituality. And the church is missing out on the opportunity to preach the gospel to a new generation, to share the gospel with a new generation, because it's so tightly wound up in these stereotypes, these cultural norms that are fickle and relative, but they won't admit it and they can't accept it. This is really cool. Let's go back for a minute to Galatians chapter 3. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free. There is neither male or female, for you are all one in Christ. This is cool because Paul, we might not understand all these terms, Jew or Gentile. Paul's basically saying, ethnically, guys, it doesn't matter what ethnicity you are in Christ, that doesn't matter. Slave or free, social status. Paul's saying, it doesn't matter what your social status is, poor, rich, doesn't matter, male or female, doesn't matter what your gender is, doesn't matter if you're a girl or a guy. Those, all those things, all these stereotypical cultural types that we cling to, stereotypes that we make so important, don't matter in Christ, right? Well, here's the truth about gender, guys. Biologically, it's really clear. Spiritually, it's not. So look, if you just observe the natural world, even human society, it wouldn't be so hard to figure out. You got guys and girls physically, but in that paradigm, you have such a wide variety of types of guys and types of girls. You have girls that are very masculine, even though physically they're women, you know, personality-wise, they can be very masculine. You have guys that are more feminine. And so, is God, like, confused? Or does God say, you know, it doesn't really matter? And there's more clear, you know, construct in the physical, but in the spiritual, emotive, mental, it's not so definite. And so that's why God creates some guys and some girls that are, phew. Why? Because spiritually things are, phew. Physically things are clear, spiritually things are opposite. Because spiritually, we are transgender. Spiritually, if you're male, you can be a lot more feminine in some characteristics and personalities and traits, right? Why? Because God doesn't give a shit about all the stuff that we think he should and say he should. God doesn't see gender the way we do. And so he's like, it's almost like God's like, ha ha, you think gender's this black and white. Look, see that guy? More feminine. See that girl? More masculine. See? See, guys? Come on, guys. Are you blind? Then it's not so black and white. So in the physical, it's more black and white. In the spiritual, opposite. So it's not hard to see. It's hard when you have a legalistic, self-righteous, religious church culture that narrows in so tightly on what it means to be Christian that people can't fit that box. And so people start leaving and they just won't do it. And God is fed up with it too. God is not interested or affirming this ultra-conservative American evangelical mentality of gotta look the right way, be the right person, talk the right way, go to the right church, wear the right clothes, or you ain't Christian. That's superficial, guys. That's superficial and surface. Guess what? Physical gender is superficial and surface. Spiritually, that's what matters. And so it's like before God created humanity, gender was non-binary. God creates gender physically binary, but still spiritually non-binary. And so after the resurrection, at the end of all days, guess what? Everything goes back to non-binary. Ooh, wait a minute. Maybe a lot of the younger generations are moving more towards that final state because we're getting closer to the end times, the end of the end times. And so maybe God's preparing us for what is to come, guys. If you're a guy and you're a Christian and you're straight, white, and scared of anything that's not so defined, guess what? In heaven, you're going to be non-binary. Ooh, might as well get used to it now, buddy. You might as well relax and go too uptight about it. In heaven, guys, we're not going to be male or female. Why? Because spiritually, there is no male or female. There's a blending. And this is really cool. I don't know if you know this, but like in the Trinity, you have these typical kind of manifestations. God the Father is more masculine. God the Spirit is more feminine. Jesus, guess what? Right in the middle. Jesus, if you look at his life, the way he acted, how emotive he was and empathic and nurturing, but also very sometimes stern, he balanced well the Spirit and the Father into one person. Jesus was a perfect balance of the masculine and feminine. Of course, he came in a male body. Why? Because at his time, culture was still stuck in a lot of negative, toxic frameworks, right? And so Jesus had to come as a man or nobody would have listened to him. But you know, Jesus affirmed women time and time and time again. Guys, he included women as disciples. He let women minister to him. He let women be a part of his ministry. It was the women, guys, that were the backbone of the ministry. They were bringing in the money and they were organizing things while he and his apostles went and did some of the other work. And then what happens? At his resurrection, guys, who's the first person to see him? A woman. Jesus was constantly elevating the status of women. Jesus had a very progressive perspective towards gender at his time, and he was moving the church towards an even more progressive attitude towards gender. Why? Because at the end of all things, when we're resurrected with new bodies, we're like the angels. We're non-binary. We're transgender. So here we are again, guys. The church is like stuck in a hole, stuck in a rut, stick up its butt. Can't accept the fact that God's changing things and the fact that the way things used to be aren't the way that they are. And it's like, oh my gosh, men are wearing dresses. Oh my gosh, Jesus wore a dress. Get over it. Just like here we are. Can we all relax and be like, okay, seeing things too much in the physical, too narrow, too surface. Spiritually, we're all transgender. Spiritually, you can be in a physical body that's male, but you can have a lot more characteristics of the feminine, and that's okay. And actually, the goal, guys, in the end, is that we would come together and balance the two perfectly. Every person, that you would be well-balanced in the feminine and the masculine. Every person. That is the goal, because why? Genesis. God perfectly balances the male and the female in one person. God is non-binary. God is transgender. Ooh, boy. Like it or not, it's what the good book says. See ya. I need another drink. Good stuff, man. Good stuff. You notice? Flowers. It's a new day, guys. We need a new church for the new generations because it's a new day and God's doing a new thing. Bam! Love you.